Good morning and welcome. My name is Holly Anderson, and I have said many times before, I am thrilled to be serving as president of the UUCR board. I had a therapist once who suggested to me that life was this simple: show up, pay attention, tell the truth. I have found this philosophy to be spot on, and I work every day to live by these words. Even when life is not simple, say for instance, there's a global pandemic, or women's rights to their own bodies are trampled, or there is a massive effort to suppress voter rights, I find that these words are applicable and a comfort to me. And what is even more wonderful is that I have found a beloved community practicing this same philosophy. So this morning, as I welcome everybody, let me also thank you for showing up, for paying attention, and for working to find and tell your own truth. I have an announcement. Next Sunday, July 17th, is our first summer intergen pop-up choir. How fun is that? Join music director Cynthia Young for our first of three summer pop-up choir events. You do not need to be a choir member to join in. Just come to the pop-up choir rehearsal in the sanctuary from 9 to 9:30 this coming Sunday morning. A simple song will be taught to sing together in the morning service, and you do not need to RSVP. Ages 9 and older are welcome. I might have to show up and do that as well. Our service today is being led by Reverend Scott Alexander. Linda Weaver, Director of Religious Education, is downstairs with the children. There is no time for all ages today. Children are invited downstairs for activities and childcare. Music Director Cynthia Young is on leave today. The music for today's service was planned by UUCR member Denise Kirwan. Yay, Denise! Denise is also serving as our accompanist today. I've heard her practicing this morning. It's absolutely lovely. Church member Cara Fortner is joining us as the hymn leader, and Lesley, Tyson is serving as our worship associate. As always, a big shout out to the rotating production team consisting of Amelia Turner, Mike Schmidt, David Nemi, and Maggie Mack. Thank you all for leading and participating in today's worship service. Now, let us center ourselves for worship. Please take some deep, quieting breaths with me. Let us enter our time of worship together as we listen to A Wild Rose by Edward McDowell, performed by Denise Kirwan.
Good morning, dear friends. As Holly has already alluded, the worries of the world are with us all this morning. Recent troubling Supreme Court decisions, crazy gun violence, the threats to our global environment, continued COVID concerns, and the insane politics of America, which threaten the very future of our democratic republic. All of these weigh on our hearts and minds. But for this summer hour, I would have you leave all this trouble for just a bit at the door and enter here with the intention this morning of regaining a measure of calm and peace and serenity. I assure you all the world's problems will still be here tomorrow for you to do battle with. But for right now, let us relax in the moment that is and the company of one another. Our opening hymn.
This morning is number 19, The Sun That Shines. The words are in your order of service, and they will be on the screen if you are watching virtually. Please join and rise in body and spirit as you are able and sing with me, number 19.
The sun that shines across the sea, the wind that whispers in the tree, the lark that carols in the sky, the fleecy clouds are sailing by. Oh, I'm as rich can be.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As Reverend Scott asks us to focus here in this room, here in this present, this poem of my friend James P. Wagner came to mind. It's called Everyday Alchemy. Alchemy, a noun, to turn lead into gold, a power that countless have sought through the ages. But the conclusions of modern chemistry have taught us this science is a pseudoscience. Alchemy does not exist. And yet, in my mind, my eyes never receive that memo, because I see alchemy every day. I see it in my cup of coffee when I turn the magic. I think of the magic of the change of these beans go through with a little hot water. I see it in the kitchen with every amazing meal cooked. I see alchemy performed masterfully through kids at the lemonade stand, taking literally the life gives you lemons quote and turning it into money. I see the alchemy in the classroom where teachers turn books and lessons into knowledge. I see it in the roads we take that have cut our long journeys down from days or weeks to minutes and hours.
I see it on the stage and television screen. I look at it in the art gallery and the museum. I see alchemy, the concept of turning something of little worth into something of great worth in almost everything I see around me. Perhaps the scientists and historians who declared alchemy a dead art have just gotten so used to the magic, so desensitized to the transmutations we perform on a daily basis when we come together, when we look at the sky, that they forgot to look deeper and appreciate everyday alchemy. Let us light this chalice to bring the alchemy of our gathering together. And will we now join together in singing our covenant? The words are printed in your, on the back of your order of service.
For those of you who are new or with joining us for the first time, please hear this as our blessing to you.
Before we go into joys and concerns, I want to express how glad I am to be here with you this morning, back from the Adirondacks, as it were. And I wanted to mention that I will be in the office all week, Monday to Friday, and I'm available for any appointments or visits that ones of you would like to make. So I'm around and accessible, and I'll be with you next Sunday to talk about some of those worries that we're avoiding this Sunday. So don't worry, you worry warts. I'll take care of you next week. I'll make you miserable next Sunday morning, okay? Great. Now is the time in our service when we share our joys and concerns so that no one has to hold them alone. For those of you who are coming into us remotely from home this morning via the miracle of Zoom, you may please light a virtual candle wherever you are. And if you wish to share a joy or concern, please do so in the chat on the Zoom. And remember, though, that that will become public when you do share it. And you can do that process as those who are here with us this morning come forward. Those of you who have something on your heart, pick up a stone for each of those things, place it in the water which holds so much of our love. And if you wish to take a stone from around the bowl to remind you about what is on your heart this week, take that stone home and place it at your breakfast table or your bedstand to remind you of what's on your heart. May our ritual of joys and concerns, sorrows and joys now begin. let us be one in spirit and affection. We hold in our hearts this hour all who are aggrieved or facing any complicated challenge or aggression in their lives. May all who need our comfort feel it coming from us, our concern. May we hold in our hearts all for whom life is difficult and troubled this hour. And may we always trust in the reassurance which people can give to one another through hard times. And let us each strive to be the kind of person who gives that reassurance and hope and comfort to others as our paths cross this day and every day. Amen.
The second Sunday of each month is our dedicated offering to an organization chosen by Social Justice and Action Committee. All of today's offering, except for pledge payments, which should be clearly marked, will go to DC Abortion Fund, DCAF. The recent Supreme Court decision to overturn Roe versus Wade makes it more important than ever to support reproductive rights. DCAF makes grants to pregnant people in the DC area, as well as those traveling to the area who cannot afford the full cost of an abortion. As their website states, we will continue to do what we have always done over the last 26 years, fund abortions. Our mission and our vision will never change. DCAF is still here. We will remain here. You may make your donation at the link in the chat and on your order of service, entering your donation into the Charity of the Month donation box in the online form. You can also write a check to UUCR with Abortion Fund, that's what I'm doing today, in the memo line and put it in the offering basket or mail it to the church. And of course, you may put cash in the offering basket. Thank you so much for your generous support of DC Abortion Fund.
I have a reading before the sermon by Neil deGrasse Tyson, a man I was able to meet. The last church I served in Vero Beach, Florida, had a celebrated speaker series, and Neil deGrasse Tyson was one of those speakers. And he was we've had a wonderful evening with a couple thousand people hearing him over that weekend. This is one of his reflections. More than two centuries ago, the great poet William Blake offered the world the most extraordinary of possibilities, to see the world in a grain of sand and a heaven in a wildflower, hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in an hour. And deGrasse Tyson says, yeah, that would be nice. Unfortunately, he goes on, most of us don't know how to hold eternity in the palm of our hands. In fact, most of us feel lucky if we can just hold it together till the end of the day. The problem, of course, is that mostly we've lost our minds. I mean that literally. Our attention is endlessly lost in the endless blur of appointments, to-do lists, worry, concern, and agitation that makes up modern life. And then he goes on, sometimes, however, for the briefest moments, we do pick up a scent that there is something more going on than this daily round of survival. But those moments pass and waves of mundane urgency swallow us up again. Tumbling through the chaos of our days to days, we wonder if Blake's vision of a broader, more expansive experience is nothing more than a poet's fancy. Can we really see the universe in a grain of sand, even as we slog through commuter traffic? Can we really hold infinity in our hands, even as we drop off the kids for violin practice? And then he goes on, the answer I believe is yes. In fact, I'm sure that the answer is yes. The connection between the everyday reality we experience and the boundless landscapes of cosmic beauty, inspiration, and joy is actually so close, so present for us. It's there in the dust on your car, in the mess on your desk, and the swirling water in your sink. How do I know this? Because I'm a scientist, damn it! And I know that science, under all its theories, equations, experiments, and data, is really trying to teach us how to see the sacred in the mundane and the profound in the prosaic. And then he goes on, the trick is in the noticing that happens by unpacking the question hidden in Blake's poem. Can we really see the whole world in a grain of sand? Through the lens of science, he concludes, we can see how even the smallest thing can be a gateway to an experience of the extraordinary if only we can practice noticing. We walk past 1,000 natural miracles every day, from the sun climbing in the sky to the arc of the birds seen out our windows. Those miracles are there waiting for us to see them, to notice them, and most importantly, to find our delight in theirs. You want some transcendence, he concludes? I got it for you. Let's start with that grain of sand. I want to begin this morning by asking, I think, you a very important spiritual question. Perhaps the most spiritual important question I could ask during this or any other summer day. Do you remember, do you really remember what the world looked like, felt like, smelled like, tasted like when you were a child? Do you remember what it was like to organically take in all of the magic and wonder of this world as a child? And here is the second part of this important spiritual question. Once in a while as an adult, can you still reconnect with that amazing world? Here's a picture of me and my brother. Wasn't I a darling little kid there? I'm there on the left. And that's my brother George, whom I just saw this week in the Adirondacks one Christmas. Let me tell you about the world I remember as a boy, and maybe it will trigger some of your childhood memories. When I was a young tow-haired lad, I lived in a wonderful enchanted world. In my boyhood innocence, the world to me was a vibrant, colorful, aromatic, and magical place where I was regularly amazed by the sheer intricacy, beauty, and majesty of things. No place was more true for this than Forest Beach. Forest Beach, a rural place in Wisconsin, about 40 miles north of Milwaukee, on the wave-kissed shores of Lake Michigan. It was about a mile of pure white sand beach, little tiny granules of white sand that would get very hot in the sun. Where I spent every summer with my family, this is the view from our cottage looking south. Sadly, after more than 50 years in the family, we had to sell this beloved 4-acre property after my mother died. But just last week, when I was back in Wisconsin visiting family, I was able on my bike to make a return emotional pilgrimage back to that place which holds so many magical memories for me. And the thing that amazed me most last week was how dense everything seemed and compressed. The walk down the road, which seemed like miles to me when I was six, is really just a couple hundred yards. I was just amazed at the scale of things and how they change. This next picture is a picture of a cottage pretty much like the one we had. Three tiny little rooms with a metal roof, one very tiny bathroom. It was, well, I'll leave that to your imagination. Lots of rickety windows, no air conditioning, and at my mother's absolute insistence, no television, NPR on the radio only. And it was perched right on the beach itself, so close to the lake that on stormy days, the wave water would splash up on the rocks that protected the cabin from the lake, up on the windows. We were certain it was going to wash away one year. It never did. But oh, how I remember the sound of those waves, especially at night when they would lull me to sleep. The Great Lakes, you know, are very large lakes. Michigan is almost 500 feet deep, and it gets rough. And let's show the next picture. The first thing I remember is the vast expanse of that magnificent lake, sometimes smooth and quiet as glass, other times rollicking in huge storms, big enough to go body surfing, which we did, 6-foot waves. I loved that place. Every time I would arrive that place by car, I'd run down to the beach to just take in the lake. I remember running down through the woods and looking at that body of water. All during the summer, both night and day, you could hear the waves faithfully arriving at the shore, sometimes extremely gentle, other times, as I said, rollicking. And the lake, no matter what personality it assumed on any given day, was a powerful living thing to me. And then there were the deep, dark, inviting forests that came right up to the dunes on the beach and enveloped our little cabin in shade. I will never forget the way the sunlight was so magically filtered by those huge maple trees, pre-Civil War maple trees that we had on the property that towered over everything. Sometimes going from the woods to the beach, we would be running at full speed and come out into the sunlight of the beach with the sand so hot it would burn your feet. It was just an amazing transition. And then if we went back into the woods, the wet, moist, green soil would just be between our toes. There were so many other magical sensations that lighted up Forest Beach. Next picture, the dance of yellow moonlight shimmering across the vast expanse of that lake at night. And then there were the brilliant flashes and rumbles of summer thunderstorms on the nighttime horizon. Have you ever seen a big lightning bolt strike a lake? Amazing. And then there was the rain, the lullaby sound of the steady rain on the cabin's metal roof in the middle of the night. Who needs a sound machine, which is what I have in Washington, actually, to sort of wipe out all the ambulance noises and fire truck noises. Who needs a sound machine when you've got that? And then the haunting yet comfortable hoots of the nocturnal owls that were in our nearby trees. And then the sweet and pungent smell of the lush green undergrowth that covered the forest floor there. And we always built bonfires on the beach, the flames leaping high into the night sky. We would gather all the driftwood that was on a couple hundred yards of either side of us, and we'd build these bonfires. And yes, sometimes we would skinny dip late at night in that cold lake, even when all reason said not to do so. I could go on and on describing all the enchanting and to me absolutely magical sensations, natural sensations of that special place from my Wisconsin boyhood. And needless to say, I pray I will always be able to carry in my mind and heart all the sights and sounds and smells and other amazing sensations of my childhood spent on that Lake Michigan beach. But the truth is, and I have been thinking a lot about this over recent days as I've been in another enchanted magical place, I've spent the last 2 weeks on the Scroon River in Chestertown, New York. In fact, Dick and B. Shields arrived there yesterday. They bought 2 weeks there at the church auction. They're there, hopefully enjoying some of the same magic that I know there. Most especially tubing down the rapids, which start just below our property. If there's enough water, you don't get a black and blue butt. It's really a lot of fun. But in any case, for many of us who've been rattling around this amazing creation for several decades, we somehow, do we not, lose the sense of enchantment, that's the word in my sermon this morning, enchantment and wonder with which, as children, we naturally come into the world. You all know the familiar quotation imploring us to see the world through the eyes of a child. And that's a lovely sentiment, but that is often easier said than done, don't you think? For those of us who are now long past what we shall call the wonder years of our youth. Somehow, and I want to talk a little bit further in the sermon about how this happens to us, somehow years upon years of our banging around this old creation robs many of us of the enchantment and wonder and awe with which we were naturally blessed as children. As we age, we somehow tragically forget in the mind's eye how to see and feel the magical world that really lies around us. It is as if our finely tuned sensory apparatus, our eyes, our ears, our noses, our tongues, our taste buds and fingertips, become world-weary, dull, if you will, to the enchantment that is inherent in the world. We become almost bored or somehow spiritually impervious to the glories of natural phenomenon which once struck us all as so special. If you look up the word enchantment in your dictionary, here's what you will find. Enchanted means that you are thrilled, enraptured, delighted, charmed, fascinated, bewitched, that you have been cast under a magical spell. Now tell me honestly, friends, when was the last time you simply looked out at the world and you truly felt enchanted as a child feels enchanted? The last congregation I served for 11 happy years was the UU Fellowship in Vero Beach, Florida, which owned and operated a nursery school for 110 children. Here are some of the two-year-olds. Every morning before I started work, before I started my world-weary work in the office, I would go down through the building and visit my two-year-olds and have a little conversation. And you all know what that's like. They are so happy and enchanted with the world. And every morning that recharged my spiritual batteries and reminded me how I could approach the world. When I was a boy in Wisconsin, I woke up every morning with the eager eyes of pure child innocence. I could see the color and freshness of my world. And I didn't have to say to my eyes and my ears and my tongue, hey, you guys, notice what's going on. They did, and I was blessed by it all. But now, in my seventh decade of life, I, like all of you, can fall victim to taking this really beautiful and interesting world around me for granted and miss the rich magic of the world that is. Sunrise and sunsets are just as brilliant as they were when I was a kid. Lakes and oceans and mountains just as amazing. And this is the advantage of travel. Travel sometimes shatters us out of the dull boredom that we get into with routine life, and we can see again when we go to the Alps or to the Tahiti a world that we had kind of forgotten about. Listen to the words of my colleague David Blanchard from upstate New York, one of our ministers. He says, our goal should be to live a life in radical amazement, to get up in the morning and look at the world in a way that takes nothing for granted. Everything is phenomenal. Everything is incredible. Never treat life casually. And then he ends, to be spiritual is to be amazed. One of my neighbors, when I lived on Cape Cod, my next door neighbor was Mary Oliver, the famous American poet. I would see her shuffling up her path to her little cottage. She wrote this poem, which is familiar to many of you, entitled This World. I would like to write a poem about the world that had in it nothing fancy, but it seems impossible. Whatever the subject, the morning sun glimmers it. The tulip feels the heat and flaps its petals open and becomes a star. The ants bore into the peony bud, and there is a dark pinprick well of sweetness. As for the stones on the beach, forget it. Each one could be set in gold. So I tried with my eyes shut, but of course the birds were singing, and the aspen trees were shaking the sweetest music out of their leaves. And that was followed by, guess what? Momentous and beautiful silence, as comes to all of us in little earfuls if we're not too hurried to hear it. As for spiders, how the dew hangs in their webs, even if they say nothing or seem to say nothing. So fancy is the world, who knows, maybe they sing. So fancy is the world, who knows, maybe the stars sing too, and the ants and the peonies and the warm stones. So happy the stones to be where they are on the beach instead of being locked up in gold. What I am passionately suggesting to you this morning as we move through another very pleasant summer, glorious summer here in Northern Virginia, with its, have you noticed, verdant green woods, its amazing sunrise and sunsets, its beautiful towering white puffy clouds and refreshing afternoon downpours, which we got yesterday, and its magical nights with the serenade of so much insect and frog love, how spiritually important it is to live in radical amazement, to stop taking this world for granted, to tune our senses to the profligate beauty of the world, to have eyes and ears and taste buds and noses ready and able to take in the enchantment of creation. But how do we do this? You know, it's easy to say, live your life in radical amazement, a radical re-enchantment, but how do we cultivate this? Well, as I've already said, for many of us, we have gotten in the bad habit of taking the world for granted, this spiritual state of staying truly awake to the magic of what is easier said than done. Our senses have grown accustomed to the routines of the world, and we've been lulled into a stupor of familiarity. So how do we re-educate and revive our senses to see the wonder and amazement? Well, I think the answer is obvious, and it's something I've talked about many times from this pulpit. We need to cultivate greater mindfulness in our day-to-day living. We need to be paying purposeful attention at tuning our senses to the miracle of what is right in front of us. We need to reawaken and remind our eyes and ears and nose buds, taste buds and nose and skin to unreservedly take in the world as we did when we were a child. Now, there are many different ways, of course, to enhance mindfulness. Let me just share one with you. Often when I'm out walking or cycling, I will try to pay attention to one certain thing. For example, biking down the WOD, I'll say, now I'm going to look at the clouds without losing track of where I am on the path. And for a while, I just look at the clouds. Then if I'm walking, I say, I'm just going to now listen to the birds. I'm going to still look where I'm going, but I'm going to focus all my attentions on listening to the birds in the world around me. By simply focusing on one single thing, when you're out in nature, you'll notice how rich that thing is and how complicated and gorgeous and enchanted it is. One thing at a time is the way you see the world in a grain of sand. Let me give you another example which may seem totally off the wall to you. This week in the Adirondacks, let's see the next picture of the mosquito. I noticed a mosquito land on my forearm as I walked my property. There are lots of mosquitoes down by the river. And who was naturally enough looking for a good spot to draw a bit of blood from me. Now, like most of you, I am no big fan of mosquitoes. In fact, I will admit, I slap them dead almost all the time when they land on me. But for whatever reason, I must have been in some special, rare, metaphysical, mindful mood. I decided not to swat this little critter. I understand it's a female mosquito. They're the ones that need the blood. Not to swat the mosquito as I usually do, but instead welcome her and watch her and watch this creature as she stuck her little needle in me and drew the blood. I watched the whole damn thing. Now, it was, have you done that ever? It was, well, you should try it, as my mother used to say. My mother, Marcia, was always right. She said, try it. Just watch that little critter take a little piece of you and then struggle to get airborne off my arm as she did with a stomach full of, well, just a little bit of me, blood I was willing to donate to creation, even if I don't understand or appreciate that particular part of creation. Mindfulness with mosquitoes. Try it. You'll like it. Now, I promise you, I am not going to be enchanted every time I'm in the woods getting consumed by mosquitoes. They're really a pest, and the black flies are even worse. But I'm making a point. By mindfully focusing on even the smallest event in creation, you can be amazed and blessed. And the point is that as a time-wearied adult, that by paying keen attention to something as a child does, have you ever seen a child watching ants? They just are fascinated with the way the ants are carrying things. Try that too. It's really weird what the ant behavior. And you allow yourself, when you enter into that mindfulness, to be blessed by the intricate magic at hand. We fail to see the amazing that is sunk down in the ordinary. But when we purposefully pause to pay attention, as it says in the Bible, when we pay attention, the scales fall away from our eyes, and we can see again, our sight is restored. But only by being mindful in everyday moments of living can we experience this re-enchantment of the world. We had it as children. Now, as adults, we are responsible to facilitate the re-enchantment of the world. The world is enchanting, but we only re-enchant it when we see it and when we participate in it. I want to close this morning with another wonderful poem by my old neighbor, Mary Oliver. It is entitled The Summer Day, and it describes the enchantment that visits the poet when on a summer day she mindfully engages a grasshopper, not a mosquito, but a grasshopper that she discovers in her yard on Cape Cod. I read it. Who made the world? Who made the swan and the black bear? Who made the grasshopper? this grasshopper, I mean, the one who has flung herself out of the grass, the one who is eating sugar out of my hand, who is moving her jaw back and forth instead of up and down, who is gazing around with her enormous and complicated eyes. Now she lifts her pale forearms and thoroughly washes her face. Now she snaps her wings open and floats away. I don't know exactly, Oliver concludes, what prayer is, but I do know how to pay attention, how to fall down into the grass, how to kneel down in the grass, how to be idle and blessed, how to stroll through the fields, which is what I have been doing all day. And then she ends, tell me, what else should I have done? Doesn't everything die at last and too soon? Tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? Amen.
Please join me in singing our closing hymn, For All That Is Our Life, which is number 123 in your hymnal. The words are also in the order of service and will be on your screen if you're watching virtually. Please rise in body and spirit as you are able.
For all that is our life, we sing our thanks and praise. For all life is a gift which we are called to use to build the common good and make our own days glad. That's all I got for you this morning.
Thank you.
thank you, Reverend Scott, for a wonderful reminder about how to be amazed. I can tell you I have a really hard time sitting in mindfulness, but as most of you know, I'm an avid gardener, and every morning at 5:30, I am out over at the garden, and I run around it like a six-year-old, seeing what is developed today. I have a baby watermelon that's this big. I have an asparagus patch. Every tomato, every squash, every zucchini, raspberries, blackberries, makes me so happy. And doing that helps me deal with what's going on that doesn't make me happy. So thank you for this week and next week. So I hope today you will talk about what amazes you. We invite our congregants attending worship on Zoom to join us for our virtual Greet Your Neighbor coffee hour today to discuss the service theme and enjoy fellowship with other congregants. The link is in the chat box and will be on a forthcoming slide. We hope you will use the chat box also as a virtual receiving line to leave a message about your appreciation for the worship service. Those here in person are invited to join us here for coffee, tea, and fellowship. We are going to leave the chairs set up as they are at the beginning of service, so please do not stack the chairs. Let's go get some coffee.